Good morning. It's been so long since I did this, I don't even know if I'm an old one anymore, so I can remember how to do that. It's good to see you here at St. Peter Lutheran Church, where we finally can gather as God's people to receive His blessings and to thank and praise Him as for those blessings. We begin our service today by singing the opening hymn. Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Give ear, O Lord, to my prayer. Teach me your way, O Lord, that I may walk in your truth. I give thanks to you, O Lord, my God, with my whole heart. For great is your steadfast love towards me. Though God, insolent men have risen up against me, a band of ruthless men seeks my life. But you, O Lord, our God, merciful and gracious. Glory be to the Father and to the Son,
and to the Holy Spirit,
as it was in the beginning,
is now, and will be forever. Amen.
Give ear, O Lord, to my prayer.
Listen to my plea for grace.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. For this holy house and for all who offer their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one but God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated for the reading of the lesson. The Old Testament reading for the sixth Sunday after Pentecost and the basis of our meditation for today is from Isaiah chapter 44. Thus says the Lord, the King of Israel, and his Redeemer, the Lord of hosts, I am the first and I am the last. Beside me there is no God. Who is like me? Let him proclaim it. Let him declare and set it before me, since I appointed an ancient people. Let them declare what is to come and what will happen. Fear not, nor be afraid. Have I not told you from of old and declared it? And you are my witnesses. Is there a God beside me? There is not no rock. I know not any. This is the word of the Lord. Oh, the depths of the riches and wisdom of the knowledge of God, how unsearchable are his judgments, how inscrutable his ways. For from him and through him and to him are all things, to him be glory forever. Amen. The epistle reading is from Romans, chapter 8. For I consider the suffering of this present time not worth comparing with the glory that is to be revealed to us. For the creation waits with eager longing for the revealing of the sons of God. For the creation was subjected to futility, not willingly, but because of him who subjected it, in hope that the creation itself would be set free from its bondage to decay, and obtain freedom of the glory of the children of God. For we know that the whole creation has been groaning together in pains of childbirth until now. Not only the creation, but we ourselves, who have the first fruits of the Spirit, groan inwardly as we wait eagerly for adoption as sons, the redemption of our bodies. For in this hope we were saved. Now hope that is seen is not hope. For who hopes for what he sees? But if we hope for what we do not see, we wait for it with patience. Likewise, the Spirit helps us in our weakness, for we do not know what to pray for as we ought. But the Spirit himself intercedes for us with groanings too deep for words. And he who searches hearts knows what is in the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for the saints according to the will of God. This too is the word of the Lord. We rise and speak together the verse of the day in preparation for the reading of the Holy Gospel. Alleluia, I will open my mouth in parables. I will utter what has been hidden since the foundations of the world. Alleluia. The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 13th chapter. Jesus put another parable before them, saying, the kingdom of heaven may be compared to a man who sowed good seed in his field. But while his men were sleeping, his enemy came and sowed weeds among the wheat and went away. So when the plants came up and bore grain, then the weeds appeared also. And the servants of the master of the house came and said to him, Master, did you not sow good seed in your field? How then does it have weeds? He said to them, an enemy has done this. So the servant said to him, then do you want us to go and gather them? But he said, no, lest in gathering the weeds you root up the wheat along with them. Let both grow together until the harvest. And at harvest time I will tell the reapers, gather the weeds first and bind them in bundles to be burned, but gather the wheat into my barn. Then he left the crowd and went into a house. And his disciples came to him, saying, explain to us the parable of the weeds of the field.
He answered, The one who sows the good seed is the Son of Man. The field is the world. The good seed is the children of the kingdom. The weeds are the sons of the evil one. The enemy who sows them is the devil. The harvest is the close of the age. The reapers are the angels. Just as the weeds are gathered and burned with fire, so it will be at the close of the age. The Son of Man will send his angels, and they will gather out of his kingdom all causes of sin and all lawbreakers, and throw them into the fiery furnace. In that place there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Then the righteous will shine like the sun in the kingdom of their Father. He who has ears, let him hear. This is the gospel of the Lord. We confess our faith in God using the words of the Apostles' Creed.
I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
You may be seated as we sing the hymn of the day. Support one another, especially in this time of crisis.
But this is what we have to go through as God's people. And sometimes that's what helps us understand more fully who and what we are. When things get thrown out all out of whack, and things happen, and we have to start deciding how we're going to do things and start looking at our lives and understanding more fully just what is important to us and what isn't. Today I want to ask a question. Because of our text from Isaiah, I want to ask you, who is God for you today? That's a slightly different question than you might think it is. I'm not asking who God is. I don't want you to recite a bunch of facts about who God is and what he does. I want you to think about who he is for you today. It's very interesting as we look at this, because it changes from day to day who God is for us. And sometimes we don't even think about it. There is a prayer that was written by an English warrior years ago, a knight. And the prayer went, "Lord, I hope that you will not lose track of me and what I am doing, for I may lose track of you today." There are some times when we depend on God because of who he is, and sometimes we just fall back on the idea that God is there for us no matter what. And then we look at the text for today in Isaiah 44. That's exactly what we're seeing. When we look at this relationship between the triune God, the God we know as the only real God, and his chosen people, the people of Israel, and all that he has gone through with them to this point. And we see where they stand right now. Because Isaiah, even though, you know, we know Isaiah because of all his wonderful prophecies about Jesus Christ, Isaiah is prophesying at a time when the people of Israel are going to go into exile in Babylon for 70-some years. For 70 years, they are going to be separated from Jerusalem, from the temple, the physical place where they had a connection with God, where they could go and know he was there. No, they couldn't see him. They couldn't go into the Holy of Holies and look at the seat of mercy and see God sitting there between the cherubim. But they knew he was there. And now suddenly that wasn't available to them. In some senses, it has a lot of things to do with what happened to us suddenly when COVID-19 got very bad and the governor of the state put us on shelter in place, and suddenly coming to this building and gathering as God's people and doing the things we'd always done and hearing the words we'd always heard and saying the liturgies we'd always said just wasn't possible. Yes, we tried to do the best we could, but it isn't the same. It isn't the same thing. There's something different about standing in front of you and preaching to you than sitting in front of a microphone in my grubby clothes and preaching to you. There's something different about getting a response. Even though I'll have to admit today the masks kind of hinder that a little bit. But it's still great to be here. And what's even better than that, it's great to gather in this place. Now we all know that this building, although we call it the church, is not the church. You are the church. You are the church of Jesus Christ. You are the people of God. You are what makes God's people operate. You are his witnesses in this place at this time. That's a wonderful thing. But today we want to get back to learning a little bit more of who God is and what he does. Now, one of the things I always think about this is we look at this text And we have a whole bunch of, well, we think of them as names for God, but technically they aren't. They're titles of God. Because if you ask what the name of God is, you have to go back to Moses when he goes to the burning bush, and God is going to send him to the people of Israel who are captive as slaves in Egypt. And Moses doesn't really want to do this. Let's face it, this is not the first thing that he ever looked to be his profession, you know, to be a professional leader of a little country, a little nation, breaking away from the slavery of a big country. But he kind of is looking for all kinds of things why he shouldn't do this. And one of the reasons he kind of uses is that, well, okay, I know you're the God, you're in this burning bush, I'm experiencing you. But when I go to Egypt and these people ask me, who sent you? Who do I tell them sent me? What is your name? And this is when God comes up with this kind of statement that sounds funny to us because it doesn't really sound like a name. He says, I am. His name is I am. And somehow that doesn't seem like it works quite right for us, but think about it for a minute. What else would he say? He can't say, I am the God of this country, which was the case in most pagan countries. You move countries, you change gods. Or, I am the God for this period of time. But he was the God who is God because he is. And that's one of his titles. That he's the God, he's the Lord, the first and the last. Or the New Testament version of it is Alpha and Omega. Always used to make me laugh because when we have the white pyramids up, then that's what they are. It's Alpha and Omega. But the only problem with that is when they made them from Mount Calvary, they put a wider one on the pulpit. And the problem is the pulpit at Mount Calvary was on that side of the church. And so if you would put them in the same place here, if you put the big, wide, long one here on the pulpit, it would be, I am Omega and Alpha, which doesn't work so good. So they always used to get them wrong over there too, and I had to check to make sure I got them right. But the idea is the first and the last. And one of the things you got to remember that in a Hebrew idiom, the way Hebrews think about something, the first and the last only deals with time. It doesn't deal with God as being the source of everything, the creator of everything. If you want to identify that in God, you call him the God who created the heavens and the earth. But this is strictly time. In other words, there was no time when there's anything around, but God wasn't. So, anyway, the name of God is I Am. All the rest are titles. God, Lord, first and last. But in Hebrew, his name is Yahweh, which means I am. Lord is Adonai. So Yahweh Adonai is the name of God. I am the Lord. It's kind of like Queen Elizabeth. You know, Queen is not her name. Queen is her title. Elizabeth is her name. So that's how kind of get understood. Anyway, when we think about this, we look at this text, we suddenly find out what's going on here. Because like I said, we're dealing with a time when Israel is going into exile. They're departing from Israel. They're departing from Jerusalem. They aren't going to have access to the temple anymore. And so some people's mind, they don't have access to God anymore. They really do, and we find that out when they're in exile through Daniel, through Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, that God is still there and active among them. But for a lot of people, they have that problem. If we can't go to the building, we can't get to God. That's not our case here. That's not our case as Christians. We know that. But anyway, so all of a sudden you have this where Isaiah is kind of prophesying about this. And the main reason for his prophesying about this is so that you know what's going on. Because otherwise, you would just look at history and say, okay, what's happening here is a big country, the Babylonians, is beating up on a little country, Israel, and taking everything and making them slaves. But when you have a prophet say, no, this is because of what you have done, and because you have left me behind and ignored me, then you understand that, no, this is something that God's doing through a big country, Babylon. But it's really God that's behind it, and he's empowering it. So God, at this point in Isaiah, is kind of trying to call people back. It's basically a call of faith. This whole chapter is a call of faith. Come back to me because I'm your God and you are my people. Something they'd forgotten and something they'd gotten away from. And yeah, Israel did that a lot. You see that a lot. You go through the whole set of Chronicles, and again you'll have this a few verses that says, so-and-so became king, and he did not follow God, or he did not honor God, and he did not burn the Asherah poles, and he did not destroy the altars of the Baal, and he died and went to be with his fathers, and somebody else's king. And again you have this same litany followed by, and everybody did what was good in their own sight, because there was no God in Israel. Now, it wasn't that there was no God in Israel, they weren't honoring the God of Israel. Literally, by this point in time, you have people that are trying to establish this special relationship. This idea that they are somehow specially related to God. And it kind of manifests itself in weird ways. People would wear signs on their foreheads or on their wrists that said, I am Jacob, or I am Yahweh's, or I am Israel, which was probably the oddest of all because they all lived in the nation of Israel. But in reality, they didn't follow God. And so God's calling them back, and that's what this whole idea of what, is there any other God like me? No, there's not. There's no God at all except me. So that's why you should return to the true God. That's why you should return to Yahweh and honor him and look to him for all good things. Because, yes, some people had fallen into this habit of, change country, change God, so they were following the gods of, the Babylonians or following the gods of some other country. The Canaanites, because they were living in the Canaanite country. That type of thing. You had some people that were worshiping, the things that God had made, the blessings of God. Nature, that was a big one. Food is a big one. Because you start to say, this is what gets me what I want. This is what makes me feel good. This is that. So that's what becomes their God. No, they didn't probably physically do worship around their food, but that's what they honored the most. And so God is calling them back and saying, no, you have to get back to knowing that, all this that's going on is because I'm calling you back to me. And you need for this to happen so that you are redeemed. So that you find someone who buys you back from your sins. So that all this stuff that went on in worship actually gets played out. The worship is symbolic. The going to the temple on the Day of Atonement, and the priest goes into the Holy of Holies and takes a goat and a lamb and lays his hands on the lamb, which is slaughtered as an offering, and lays his hands on the goat, and the goat is the scapegoat, which takes all the sins of the people and they chase it out into the wilderness. Those things are symbolic of what will happen in Jesus Christ. And Yahweh, God of Israel, God of the entire world, is calling them back to him and saying, this is what has to happen. You have to to be my people. We have to do things a certain way. And in some senses, this is kind of what today is about, too. You know, when Mike and I talked and we thought about the problems that were happening with COVID-19 and how even though things were getting more relaxed, the actual incidence of COVID were increasing dramatically, that we needed to look at whether we could have church consistently week after week. And we decided that maybe for a while it would be better if we would do it once a month. Now, why once a month? Either have it all the time or don't have it all the time. Well, because there are some things we need to do. We need to come here as God's people and see each other and support each other as God's people. We need to come here as God's people and receive the Lord's Supper. Because that's a place where God says, if you come, I will be acting here on your behalf. This is one of the places I work. He guarantees it. Last Sunday, we talked about his word, how his word is a place where he works and he guarantees it. This is another place where he works and he guarantees it. We need to do that. But we need to be safe about it, and this is how we've come to this. The best way that we can distribute the blessings of God and still honor the authorities and the people around us who are trying to contain this great pandemic and do as much as we can to help them, because God has placed them over us. It is looking prayerfully and deciding what we can do best, how we can work best as his people. And once again, we look at this. And we look especially at the text today, and we understand that Jesus Christ came and laid down his life and fulfilled all these promises of God. And God calls us back day after day to this simple thing, with that same basic statement. There is no other God. There is no one else who cares for you and loves you and basically gave up his life to redeem you and bought you back. Holds out for you the promise of an eternity in his care. Yahweh, the Lord, the one and only. And then he says, don't be afraid. Don't be frightened. I will take care of you. I have called you in the past. I have made you mine forever. Your future is secure that you might live under my care for all time. He is the rock that is stable, our fortress and our foundation, that which we can depend on and build an entire life on. Not only for this life, but for all eternity. Amen. And the peace of God which surpasses all human understanding, keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus unto eternal life. Amen.
Baptismal vocation of worship, witness, prayer, and working of mercy. Lord,
both for our families and our neighbors in need. Lord, in your mercy. Blessed Lord, we are stewards of your creation, but we have often squandered its goodness and wasted its resources. Guide us to use wisely and for the benefit of all people the fruits of this good earth, and to preserve its goodness for those to come. Lord, in your mercy. Merciful God, you have given new baptism, a new birth in baptism. Help us to confess your Son before the world, reflect the glory of your kingdom to all people. Bless all pastors, missionaries, and church workers, that they may be faithful in their callings. Lord, in your mercy. Gracious Lord, we enjoy great freedom and blessing in our land. Bless Donald, our President, the Congress of the United States, J.B., our Governor, and all those who make, judge, and administer our laws in this land. Give them wisdom in their actions for the protection of life and livelihood. Lord, in your mercy. Loving God, we give you thanks for the gifts of health, which we must never take for granted. Hear our prayers on behalf of the sick, the aged, the infirm, those who mourn, and those near death. Grant them healing in accordance to your will, and grant to sustain them in their need. Hear us especially for Brandon, Petra, Rick, June McFarland, June Nunnery, Judy, Cheryl, Aaron, Pastor Brian Downey, Claire, Zachary, Pastor Jim Lucas, Pastor John McCumsky, Maddie, Daniel, Terry, Michelle, John, Janet, and Paul. Lord, in your mercy. Holy Lord, we too easily forget those in nursing homes, assisted living, and those who are homebound. Especially we pray this day for Petra, Rick, and June. Give us grace so that we may bring them your consolation and peace, and give them aid and comfort of your word and our fellowship in Christ. Lord, in your mercy. Heavenly Father, we are wounded by the sufferings of this life, and we need your grace to sustain us in hope and equip us with patience. Give to us all that we need to pass through this day of trouble and be found faithful when Christ comes in his glory at the last day. Lord, in your mercy. Heavenly Father, preserve us in hope of things unseen until we see your Son in glory. Grant that we might receive him in your holy supper with hearts filled with pride, presumption, and be able to resist other sins that would leave us guilty before him in his body and blood. May we humbly rejoice at his real presence there for the forgiveness of sin and that life and salvation that we obtain. Lord, in your mercy. Gentle Lord, we ask you to visit the homes of your people, that they may be places of blessing and love, where faith is nurtured, and we learn to live out our new lives in holiness and righteousness all the days of our lives. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, hear us on behalf of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Grant that what we pray for, we may work together and under your guidance with the Holy Spirit, and that on the day of judgment we may be found worthy to join the saints and enter into your eternal life and peace forevermore. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. You may be seated for a minute as we discuss the Holy Communion. For those of you who weren't here the last time we did this, we will do communion by family unit. And so we'll come up one family at a time. And you come up here to the altar, and I will do communion individually. I'll be doing everything as safely as I possibly can. Obviously, you're going to have to remove your masks. I will not be touching these kids when I bless them, but have them come forward for a blessing, and we'll do this as quickly and easily as we possibly can. Now, because this is going to take longer, we will not sing the communion hymn here where we usually do. We will sing it during the distribution. Two communion hymns, and you can sing as much as we get through. I guess when you come forward, start in the front and, just come forward. Please wait for your seat until the last family group has seated before you. get up and come forward. So as little close contact as possible. We try to do this as safely as possible. At that point, I guess, please rise and we'll continue with the liturgy of communion. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened up to us the way of everlasting life. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying, this salutary gift, and we implore you of your mercy. You would strengthen us through the same, in faith toward you and in fervent love toward one another. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace.
Amen.
You may be seated, and we sing the closing hymn.